This video is a foray into reviewing some select vehicles, ones that catch my attention at least. I have a better established series called Picture Cars, which asks the question, is this the right vehicle for the movie, TV, or video game character? In these car reviews, I'm going to ask a derivative of that same question. So, in the example of the Ford Maverick, which is marketed for makers and doers, here is how the question would be asked. If I was in the Maverick's target audience and I was the main character in a movie, would I be driving a Ford Maverick? As I've been making my picture cars videos, I've been looking at my own cars and asking similar questions. If I were the main character in a movie, would I be driving a Chevrolet Equinox? If a movie was being made about me and I could watch it, would I want my character to be driving the Knox? Now the answer to that question is obviously no, which is part of the reason I have car projects of my own, but this video is about the Maverick, so let's get started. I want to first break down what this target audience looks like, in a sense, defining who the character is if we were to put him or her in a movie. Ford and every other intelligent automaker does something similar whenever they design a vehicle. However, where Ford would identify needs and identify their demographic, I am taking their defined demographic and breaking down what those needs would be in a visual story. Being a maker isn't the same thing for everyone. There are those who use 3D printers, are woodworkers, welders, circuit makers, hackers, artists, and so many more unmentioned yet equally accoladed makers in and out of the industry. There are a couple of distinctions that need to be made in order to have the appropriate dialogue for questioning whether this truck fits the maker market. First, makers don't have to be employed in their craft. There are plenty of blue-collar service professionals with full-size trucks and cargo vans. There are many outsiders who would rightfully ascribe them to be makers while simultaneously saying that they are the extent of what a maker can be. Yes, a construction worker is a maker, a masonry layer, also a maker, an electrician, equally a maker, but a physical therapist can also be a maker. What I'm saying is anyone working a job but also building creative solutions to everyday needs is also a maker. In the place where you spend the third most amount of your time, your car, how do you nurture that maker mindset? Second, makers don't have to be craftspeople. Another way to say this is that makers don't have to be professional, but that wording is redundant to the previous point. What I'm really trying to say here is that the entry bar level for the status of maker is set low on purpose, to welcome the diversity required for creative solutions. And so there needs to be a vehicle that meets these entry-level makers at this low entry point and transports them to progression. To say that every DIY project needs to be made from hardwood is ridiculous. In turn, in my classroom, to say that only students on the AB honor roll are allowed to be makers is just as equally ridiculous. It's my job to invite and nurture as many makers as I can introduce into the world after high school. How does a vehicle invite and nurture those same qualities? Third, to make is to save. In this last point, I want to give proper voice to the DIYer whose sole reason for exposure into the world of hammers and wrenches is to save money, or preserve a family craft, whether it's a family recipe or homebrewed wood finish, or promote greener living by locally sourcing and building rather than giving their money to large corporations in need of Class 8 transportation. Nick Offerman, the man's man, takes a whole section of his book, Good Clean Fun, to ease the minds of these entry-level makers. He explains in detail why his woodworking practices are net positive for the environment. I encourage you to explore that book more because it's good, clean fun. And so to meet the myriad of maker in both her diverse demographic and experiential backgrounds, which saves on money, saves a skill, or saves the environment, there needs to be a more accessible, more friendly maker vehicle than the Ford F-150 or Chevrolet Silverado. I've seen my fair share of gardeners and artists using the small SUV segment to transport their plants, soil, tools, canvas, and supplies to and from their respective studios. I am the father in a home of future mini makers with a Ford Probe, Chevy Equinox, and Dodge Grand Caravan. Are these the best vehicles for the different jobs we've undertaken over the past year? The stone-go option from our Grand Caravan was nice for transporting shingles, flooring, baseboards, and so much more, but it hasn't been the easiest vehicle to work with. And the focus here is ease. How do you make something that has the space of a small SUV but is more accessible? When unloading projects, tools, supplies, there really is nothing better than the old-fashioned bin. Toolboxes got a lot better when drawer slides were introduced. The decked truck bed is a testament to this. But other than the bin, there's no better blank system of storing a variety of optionable projects. But there are so many different use cases between makers, from artists to musicians to fabricators, and so there needs to be some customizability when it comes to that storage bin. Lift gates are great options on SUVs when you start thinking about security and protection against the elements. But if your projects expand the envelope of the lift gate, then you lose those benefits. And so you need a bed that provides adequate security, but more importantly, ease of loading, unloading, and strap securing. The Ford Maverick project developers had a team dedicated solely to what they call the FlexBed system. Because of that team's work, there were subdivisions for storage DIY solutions and eDIY, or electrical DIY, which is really just DIY with a specification, but I'm not going to gripe too much. And so there becomes this ulterior motive behind Ford's marketing push into the world of makers and doers. In a word, it's encouragement. Ford is essentially encouraging you to try out different methods of DIY inside of the trademarked FlexBed, as well as inside the cabin of the vehicle with their Ford integrated tether system. In their market research, they were witnessing so many DIY methods of drilling into sheet metal, improper use of grommets, or lack of grommets in general. Put simply, methods which Ford wouldn't endorse.
We found things that we would not want to endorse, and we set out to better enable those same things in a way that we would endorse.
In my own experiences with my project cars, I've seen similar poor electrical DIY hacks from previous owners. Electricity is a hard subset to forge into, so how does Ford present that avenue in a more inviting way? Instead of chastising, the Maverick team created more endorsable methods to fill those same solutions, including running alternating current through the bed for the Lariat trim level. No further need to wire bed LEDs from the battery cables. Ford makes solutions to many of these obstacles, such as a dedicated bike rack. But Ford's encouragement of not buying the specific product for strapping down bikes is a welcome change to the industry. The added FlexBed page navigated through QR code in the truck bed has further suggestions of converting your bed into a purpose-built, customized, bespoke truck bed to meet the maker's needs. I wasn't convinced the Maverick would be a good idea. Back when I was in the automotive industry, we were awarded baffle models for both the Maverick and what was then called the Mach 1 and is now the Mustang Mach-E. As is often the case in the early days of development, especially at those kickoff meetings, we didn't know what the car would look like, only what class of vehicle it was going to be. For the Maverick, we didn't even know it was going to be a truck at the time. We still assumed we were resurrecting the car model. I was hesitant about the news that it would be a small truck. We were already making a lot of P375 parts, which platform was the resurrection of the Ford Ranger. And so seemingly, Ford was already making a small truck as the bridge between sedan and the F-150. I've taken to describing it like the Gotham PD HBO Max show that Warner Max is developing. They're only making it because the Batman intellectual property is successful. But they've already made a show about the Gotham Police Department on Fox. So to transition the metaphor, Ford would only be making the Maverick because of the highly successful F-150. But they've already made a smaller truck in the Ranger. It seems like a money grab because we all know that both the Gotham PD show and the Maverick will be successful. And by extension, because it seemed like a greedy money grab, I was going to hate it. I don't like when production vehicles are rendered obsolete or redundant. The Maverick appears redundant to the Ranger. But I think the Maverick ends up extending the olive branch to sedan owners better than the Ranger. If we were to look at the Venn diagram of the needs that are met between the two smaller Ford trucks, then the advantages that the Maverick has over the Ranger are much more inviting to me as a coupe owner. I wasn't in favor of this release. We had so many months of camouflage and factory spy shots for me to build some real resentment about this vehicle. But the marketing and message of this truck did more to help sell this product than I saw with, heck, the Bronco Sport, which shares the same platform. Is this Ford's best designed vehicle for the maker? It would appear that way. If the maker was the main character of a movie, would he be driving a Ford Maverick? I honestly can't think of anything else that would compete for that question. There aren't very many Hyundais in movies anymore. Its best exposure being The Walking Dead. And anymore, small SUVs are being purpose-built for people moving and not cargo moving. It will be interesting to see the market response to Ford's claim of the Maverick being the maker's truck. I said a few paragraphs ago that this is the best designed vehicle for the maker. What I'd like to do in the future is get behind one of these and see how encouraging it is to the DIYer. For example, are the basic maintenance needs of the Maverick inviting for the maker? How readily can you make something for the Ford integrated tether system? There are so many more questions that an in-person assessment would answer. This series makes more sense when thinking about the supplemental questions of redundancy. Chevrolet's Equinox, Blazer, Trax, and Trailblazer share much in their four-sided Venn diagram. So would you ever see the main character drive a Trax, an Equinox? Mary Barra, GM CEO, said to her employees in 2013 that they would no longer be building crappy cars. But even if they aren't making subjectively crappy cars, many of them seem redundant to their target audiences. The Maverick and the Ranger share similar demographic range. But the Maverick is better marketed for the city maker, while the Ranger is better suited for the outdoor adventurer. What I want is a future where automakers aren't just efficient with their emissions, but more efficient in their design process. Because it's painful to see the Trailblazer when the Blazer itself could have been so much more. I want your feedback with this series. I like doing picture cars, but I don't think it connects with my audience unless I also make these videos. My brother-in-law, Trace Brady, has written and is writing a series of character workbooks. In one of them, titled Create Yourself, you build your character in the story of life. Every person yearns for that feeling of empowerment and of feeling like their story means something. It's why I started making picture cars videos and asking the question, does this car make sense for its character? But in doing so, I myself started realizing it doesn't make a ton of sense for me to drive a Chevrolet Equinox. I don't want to drive an Equinox, and if a movie was ever going to be made about me, I don't want the main character to drive an Equinox. So what would he be driving instead? The Maverick seems a good contender, but I don't have an answer right now and probably won't for some time. So the feedback I want from you is to leave a comment of your daily driver and why it makes sense for you. Tell me your story. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, hit the like button. I encourage you to check out my picture car series if you, like me, are searching for your movie-worthy vehicle. Finally, make sure to subscribe because there's more content coming your way. Thanks again, and I'll see you all in the next one.